A drug addict who overdosed and died for 30 minutes.
I was so exhausted physically and mentally, I just couldn't do it. I couldn't do it anymore.
His story of hope and rescue on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show. Drug addiction. It's plagued the lives of many celebrities. Whitney Houston, Amy Winehouse, and recently, it took the life of Philip Seymour Hoffman. Lee Vozel knows firsthand the dangers of addictions. He had a $500-a-day heroin habit until the day it killed him.
It was just one day, about two blocks from where we are now, where I went to school. There was a playground in the back, and it was like recess time, and we went out, and we got high.
Smoking pot wasn't anything 12-year-old Lee Vozel planned on or even thought about. But the first time he got stoned, he was hooked.
I knew that, you know, obviously something wasn't right by doing it, but it numbed the pain that I had already experienced in life.
Much of that pain came from watching his younger brother suffer from muscular dystrophy. And while his parents spent most of their time caring for his brother, Lee was on his own partying with friends. Then, at 14, he started selling drugs.
By 15 or 16, I was making more money than my mom and dad were working two full-time jobs. I thought I was invincible. I thought that, you know, I had cars, I had girlfriends, I had money, I had drugs. I was great.
His parents had their suspicions, but all of their attention was focused on caring for his brother. So they just looked the other way. Meanwhile, Lee's drug use was getting worse. Now it wasn't about masking the pain, it was about getting high.
Everything escalated from that point. It went into cocaine, it went into crack cocaine, where sometimes I would smoke crack cocaine for 12 days straight, spend, you know, $20,000 and just get high the entire time.
Then he started using a more expensive and even more addictive drug.
And then the last 3 years, I wind up IV using it. So I used the needle. I would use 50 bags of heroin every day for the final 3 years. So that's $500 every single day. I just didn't care about anybody else but myself, including, you know, my family. My brother had passed away at that point. My mom and dad got divorced. So I was pretty much, you know, reckless.
But it didn't stop there. Lee ran out of money feeding his addiction, and now he feared for his life.
I owed the drug dealer so much money that I was not able to get any more drugs to sell and make more money. So by this time, I was so far in debt, I was scared that somebody was gonna kill me, that I had to pretty much hide out.
He ended up living in an abandoned house in town. He survived on money he borrowed from his mom.
I was so exhausted physically and mentally, I just couldn't do it. I couldn't do it anymore. And I knew at that point that there was something different that I wanted. I just wasn't sure how I could get out of the lifestyle that I was living.
Lee tried drug rehab 10 different times, but it never helped. Finally, his mother convinced him to enter a Christian-based recovery program called Hope Home. There he met Brian Bolt, a pastor and former drug addict.
Yeah, when I first met Lee definitely was struggling in life, and Lee definitely didn't want anything to do with God.
Pastor Brian took Lee to the recovery home and sent him upstairs to unpack his clothes. He didn't know Lee had a stash of heroin.
I heard this loud thud. I heard people say, "Pastor, Pastor, come upstairs." Ran upstairs. Lee's laying on the ground, And that time he's purple, and I see a needle and an empty bag of heroin next to him. And I told the guys, call 911. I could tell he just overdosed on a bag of heroin. And I could tell he wasn't breathing. And I just began to pray. I didn't really know what to do because I knew this man wasn't right with Jesus. One of the paramedics said this, and I'll never forget it. This man's been dead for 30 to 40 minutes. We're gonna make one last attempt to revive his life.
Paramedics injected Lee with Narcan, a drug used to offset a heroin overdose. And it worked. When Lee arrived at the hospital, Pastor Brian was waiting.
I said, you know, Lee, you were dead. And I said, we are all dead in our sins before Christ. But when we have Christ, we have life and life abundantly.
This day, I confessed to Jesus with my heart and my mouth and said, I can't do this anymore. I need you. And immediately, he came into my life and delivered me from a 26-year addiction instantaneously.
The next day, Lee was on a train to California headed to another recovery home called Victory House. He lived there for 16 months and saw how Jesus Christ was making him into a new person.
I was there maybe a week, and the guy next to the bunk and me, and I said, man, I'm starting to feel something on the inside. And he said, well, if it's on the inside, it must be Jesus. I said, I like this Jesus thing, you know what I mean? Because it was like a high that I didn't have to get high, that wasn't like harming my body.
Since then, Lee hasn't touched a single drug. He's now married, and he and his wife, Julia, have a son named Titus. He's thankful to God for his family, his life, and his freedom from addiction that came through Jesus Christ.
That day, I no longer wanted to live the way that I lived before. It happened so suddenly. I mean, it was just one simple sentence and everything has changed forever. I know what Christ did in my life, and it's simple. And knowing that, I know he could do it for another individual as well. Yeah.
And he can do it for you if you just let him. What does the Bible say about addiction? When you start looking at it, and certainly in some of the recent celebrity deaths, there's been a lot of talk both sides. Is it a disease? Is it their own fault? What's going on here? Why is addiction so prevalent in our culture? Why is it so prevalent in humanity? Why do we voluntarily become slaves to alcohol, to drugs, to heroin, whatever the drug of choice is? Why do you submit to it? And what is that? And where is that? You look at it as a disease. Well, it's a lot more than a disease because it affects your heart. It affects your soul. Things you never thought you would do, you do. You'll lie, you steal, you'll sleep under a bridge, you'll do all kinds of things just for the drug. So why is that? Well, here it is from the Bible. It's from Hosea chapter 4, verses 11 through 12. Harlotry, wine, and new wine enslave the heart. My people ask counsel from their wooden idols, and their staff informs them, for the spirit of harlotry has caused them to stray, and they have played harlot against their God. When you understand that drugs, alcohol, harlotry enslave your heart, then that starts to explain a whole lot about the compulsion to use, the compulsion to go back to the very thing that's destroying your life. You've fallen in love with it. It's become your idol. And it's also become your God, where you've replaced God and seeking him and seeking his counsel and seeking the wonderful inspiration that can come from knowing that he's in you, that he's with you. You've replaced it all with a substance. And you think, well, if I just go back to the substance and if I just get high, then everything's going to be okay. Even when you know it's not going to be okay. because you're running out of money, you're running out of family, you're running out of people you can lie to, you're just playing catch up, and you know you're never going to catch up. And you also know there are not enough drugs in the world to fill that. And whatever it is you're chasing, you know you're never going to catch it. It's never going to be enough. It's never going to satisfy. Why? Because you're enslaved. And not only are you enslaved to a little, you're enslaved to a lot. And just as Lee, he went from, you know, just casually using to 50 bags of heroin a day. Now, when Lee started out, did he intend to become an addict? No. I doubt it ever even entered his mind it would happen to him. I bet he thought he was invincible. That happened to other people. It's not going to happen to me. But then he got caught, and then he got enslaved, and he fell in love with it. And it just kept on getting worse until finally he overdosed and fell dead. Now, that's what in addiction circles we call hitting rock bottom. That this is something that you don't come back from. But Lee did. And what happened to him? Same thing in Hosea chapter 5, verse 15. Then they will seek my face. In their affliction, they will earnestly seek me. And when you turn and when you earnestly seek God, he'll come. The amazing thing is he's not angry at you. He's not mad at you. He's not going to blame you for being an addict. He's going to say to you, you're my child, and I want you to come home. All you have to do is earnestly ask him. It's as simple as what Lee did. Here he is. He's come back from the dead, and he's in a hospital, and he's saying, he heard the good news that all sinners are alike. You're dead in sin. You're dead in an addiction. You're not really living. You're going from fix to fix to fix. You're not living. You're dead. And he heard the good news that you can awake from that to newness of life if you just turn and seek him, and seek him earnestly, not just lip service, but really mean it. And then you walk into this wonderful promise in Hosea chapter 14. Return to the Lord your God, for you have stumbled because of your iniquity. Take words with you and return to the Lord. Say to him, take away all iniquity. Receive us graciously, for we will offer the sacrifices of our lips. What is God looking for? He's just looking for you to say it. Jesus, will you take me? Will you have me? Will you have me once again? Will you be my Lord? Will you be my Savior? And if you say that earnestly, with all of your heart, he'll come. Now, for some of you, you're wondering, well, is there really a God? Does he really care? Does he really love me? Is he really there? Here's a prayer for you. Jesus, if this is real, if what happened to Lee Vozel really happened, can you show me? Can you show up for me? Do you love me just the way I am? And can you change me? Can you take off these shackles? Can you free my heart so I don't love the thing that's killing me? And if you pray that, he'll answer. He'll show up. He hasn't disowned you. He hasn't said, you're not my child. He loves you. And he loves you so much that he died for you so that he could set the captives free. So if you want this, all you have to do is pick up the phone and make a toll-free call and say, I'm here to confess. I'm here to return to the Lord. I heard that verse in Hosea. All I have to do is bring these words. There'll be somebody on the other end of the line. We're not here to judge you. We're not here to condemn. We're here to let you know that Jesus can set you free. And if you'll do this one simple thing, if you'll confess your sins, he'll be faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And he'll come and live in you. And just like Lee, you'll feel that, and you'll understand it. You'll have the peace that passes all understanding. The thing you've been searching for all this time is a relationship with God, and it's yours for the asking. So call us, 888-777-1999. Well, still ahead, how viewers like you have rescued abused women right here in America. That's next.
Having some pains between my shoulder blades. At that point, everything changed. Diagnosis, pancreatic cancer. First, there was prayer. The second is to fight. As soon as we walked through those doors at Cancer Treatment Centers of America, all my anxiety left. The pastoral care here is based on the Bible, based on the Word of God, just as it is at our own church.
When you combine the great medicine with the spiritual resources we have, it provides the patients with something that really can make a difference.
You got a pastor right there on staff praying with patients, and whether it be scripture or whether it just be a word of encouragement to say God's got this.
If you or someone you love is fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com/faith. You'll learn how our treatment results compare to national averages and see a list of insurance plans with which we've worked. Advanced medicine and technology, the warm embrace of the Spirit.
I firmly believe God led me here.
Call or go to cancercenter.com. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits. Appointments available now.
Start planning your journey to the Holy Land. Come to Jerusalem. Breathe the air Jesus breathed that very night in the Garden of Gethsemane. Walk in his footsteps to Golgotha. Step inside the tomb. See the stone where his body lay. Glory to God, he is risen. Ask your pastor or visit GoIsrael.com to learn more about making the journey that will transform your faith in God and his word. Experience Israel. You'll never be the same.
For 25 years, the New Life Home has opened its doors to women and children. It's given them an education, job skills, and most importantly, a safe place to call home.
New Life Home for Women and Children in Manchester, New Hampshire is a free Christian treatment center that offers hope to women struggling with destructive lifestyles. All that's required is that they commit to reclaiming their lives. Women in the program learn basic skills such as home care, budgeting, and discipleship. The program is unique because mothers can bring their children with them. Executive Director Grace Rosato explains.
It is such a healing process for both moms and children because they grow together, they learn together.
CBN has partnered with New Life Home for over 25 years, providing help when it's needed most.
CBN has been such a wonderful support to us. There were critical times in this ministry that I don't know how we would have continued on. The need for food through Operation Blessing. When we put on an addition, adding 6 more bedrooms, meeting the needs here, CBN came alongside of us so that more women and children can find new life in Christ.
One of these women is Rose. She grew up in the foster care system and came to New Life Home after trying to commit suicide.
This place is like no other. For the first time, I have a family that comes alongside and supports me, that encourages me, that prays me through my tough times. I was told that I would never graduate from high school, to step out and actually to walk across the stage and get my bachelor's degree. I can't even explain that feeling of, God, you did this, because I knew that in myself I couldn't do it, and that God would see me, and that God would help me to become something more than anybody else thought I would be.
Now, Rose is pursuing her master's degree in Christian ministry. She's grateful to CBN partners for helping support the ministry of New Life Home.
It's because of them that I have a second chance at life, that I have a new opportunity and hope for the future. If I didn't come here, I wouldn't be alive. I probably would have taken my life.
If people are giving to CBN, they are actually giving to ministries just like this. They are giving hope to women and allowing them the opportunity to find new life.
You can be a part of it. You can be a part of giving hope to people around the world. How? Just join the 700 Club. It's real easy. Call us. 888-777-1999. How much is it? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. And you join with tens of thousands of people that want to help people, that want to make a difference in the world. So if that's you, call us now. Well, coming up, she thought she'd met the love of her life. Instead, she met her pimp. Hear how one woman was rescued from a life of prostitution right after this.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Many young girls dream of being swept off their feet by their Prince Charming. And Tanya Street was no different. She thought she'd met her knight in shining armor until she realized that he was her pimp.
I could be the sun in your sky. I could be the stars in your eyes. I could be your favorite love song. You could be my road leading home.
I was always a fanatic of love and I was very romantic or, you know, always dreamt of course, being a Disney princess.
The storybook life became just a shadow of a dream. Innocence lost to her stepfather as a child. A heavy weight was placed on young shoulders. Tanya's desire to be loved pushed her into the arms of unfulfilling relationships.
I was 17 years old when I got pregnant. I was in my senior year in high school, and everyone knew me as a church girl. I always wore dresses all the time, so they're like, how did you get pregnant? I'm like, the same way you did, or the same way you have sex, I just got pregnant, okay? But I knew abortion wasn't an answer for me. I knew that I had to face whatever it was, the baby wasn't the problem.
Tanya delivered a baby boy, but the joy of new life was silenced by the depression looming over her.
I already wanted to commit suicide so many times, but with him being in my life and now having to take care of him, life began to change for me. I have my little one, and he is just a couple months, and we're going on our senior trip to an amusement park, and that's when I meet my pimp. I really was a perfect target for him. It's definitely not something that a woman or a girl walks right into. They work really hard to just be that knight in shining armor to come alongside of you and deceive you. He was really great at letting me dream.
After months of happiness, the fairy tale ended with a phone call.
He said his mom was a madam, and she had ladies, you know, working, you know, they would make money by having sex, and, you know, she would protect them, you know, until they were able to come up with money to do whatever they wanted to do. I was receiving a welfare check because I had a son, and I was getting food stamps, and, you know, I was on Section 8, and I was getting ready for college on government money. So, you know, and so he brought out all of that. And I go, oh no, I could never do that, you know. And he says to me, well, he said, how many people have you had sex with so far? You're not getting child support, not getting any of this. So, you know, what makes you different than anyone who's working? He said, actually, you're the hoe, not them, because they're getting paid for what they do. It did something to me. I knew that, you know, I was already wrong. I thought about that. Wow, who am I to call someone else this when what I'm doing is wrong as well?
Desperate for acceptance, Tanya fell for his lies. She agreed to sell herself for money because of her love for the man.
Emotionally, you feel trapped. You find yourself being different people in order to cope with what's going on. It went on, off and on, for about 2 years.
The pimp turned violent, the streets dangerous. Hope came in the dark of night.
So I get in the car with this guy, and he starts driving, so I tell him where to go, and he doesn't turn, and he doesn't even say anything. So I'm thinking, okay, I'm in big trouble here. I'm trying to talk some sense into him, and he's just not listening. So he keeps going, and I have no idea where I am. I know that I'm lost, and he pulls into this gravel parking lot, and he stops the car, and he goes, give me your money. And I'm like, I just got beat for losing money. There's no way I'm getting out of this car without my money. And so he pulls out a knife. And as I'm struggling with him, I mean, literally a voice comes and say, you had a son. Like, you know, and it just hit me, like, what am I doing? Like, that was the first time I just felt anything different than what I was feeling, like a wake-up call. Take the money out, give it to him, and he opens the car and, pushes me out the car, and I'm just like, what am I gonna do, you know? And so I'm in this pit, right? And I yell out to God, and I go, where are you? Where are you? And I'm just crying, and I just start walking because I don't know where I'm going. And I have nothing. I have no money. I have nothing. I have on my we call it hooker dress. I had on my hooker dress and my heels, and that was it. So a police car comes up, and I'm thinking, good cop, bad cop, don't know. But he calls me over. And so I go over to his car, and he goes, what are you doing out here? And I go, well, what do you think I'm doing out here? You know, are you gonna take me in or what? Because I really don't wanna think about how I'm gonna go back to my pimp. And, you know, I'm just crazy right now. I don't know what to do. And he says, are you tired of being out here? And I said, well, yeah. Then he asked me where did I live and if I was from the area, and I told him that I wasn't, I was from out of state. He said, well, if I pay for you to get on a bus and go back home, will you promise to leave and not come back? And of course he says, you know, I have to give us the name of your pimp. I'm like, yes, I will do that. I'm thinking, yes, this is definitely my way of escape. And he did. I get in his car, and I'm still waiting for him to, you know, try something, but he doesn't. He's such a gentleman. You know, he just lets me sleep. He finishes shift at work. He goes back to the police station. And he just lets me stay in the car, and I sleep all night, just sleep. And he takes me to the bus stop and pays for my ticket. And I go get my son, and I begin to really give my heart to God. It was such a long process of trusting again because of everything that had happened in my life.
With time and prayer, Tanya has found freedom from her past.
I loved how God rescued me. I always think of the scripture about him rescuing me from the miry clay. And I know I was in a pit and I was in miry clay. I didn't know how to get out. And he definitely found a way for me to get out.
And he'll find a way for you to get out. He'll show you the way. You'll hear that voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. If God's been speaking to you, if he's been saying, what are you doing? If that's been spoken to you, heed it and turn to him. He's able to do exceedingly above all that you can ask or think. He's able to give you your life back. He's able to give you joy. He's able to set you in a family. All you have to do is ask him. So if you're a prodigal and you want to come home, give us a call, 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to meet Jesus today, and we'd be glad to pray for you. We leave you this word from Luke. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. God bless you. We'll see you again.